Good afternoon and welcome to the FEMA Region 2 Individual and Community Preparedness Webinar Series. My name is Allison Albright and I'm the Regional Preparedness Liaison for FEMA Region 2. I'm going to provide a few technical considerations before we begin. Today's proceedings are being recorded and captioned. The archived event will be available on the FEMA website in the coming weeks. You should hear audio through your computer speakers, so please ensure that your volume is turned up so you may hear the proceedings accordingly. In the top right corner, we ask if you'd like to receive news and updates from Region 2. If so, please enter your email address and we'll be sure to add you to the distribution list. And just to make a quick note, we are using webcams today, so that email list is going to be between the captions and the Q&A pod. We will have a question and answer session after the presentation concludes. You'll see a Q&A pod in the lower right-hand corner. Please feel free to submit your questions about the subject matter there, and time permitting, we'll do our best to answer them. Finally, the PowerPoint presentation from today will be available for you to download in the file share pod as a PDF. You can click on the file and download it using the download button. With that, I'd like to turn it over to the Region 2 Community Preparedness Officer to introduce our speaker and today's proceedings.
Helps if I turn off the mute button, right? You'd think number 115 that I'd have this down right by now. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Debbie Costa, the Regional Preparedness, Community Preparedness Officer for FEMA Region 2. On behalf of our team working to strengthen preparedness across the region, I'd like to welcome you to our preparedness webinar series. In FEMA's four-year strategic plan, the agency's goal one is to build a culture of preparedness. The Region 2 Individual and Community Preparedness Program is focused on preparing communities for disasters by providing useful information and training, inspiring people like you to take action and be ready for any emergency. As part of that goal, we're pleased to be hosting today's webinar, the second in a series of three on powerful presentations. FEMA Region 2 will be hosting a series of communication webinars covering techniques to improve public speaking skills on emergency management topics. Each session will take a deep dive into a presentation element in a fully interactive environment where the audience will have a significant role. In this session, we will learn how to add stories in presentations to make the complex understandable and relate core messages to inspire action. Our presenter throughout this series is Thomas Song. He has been practicing the oldest profession in the world, sales, for 25 plus years. For more than half that time, he worked on Wall Street using improving sales techniques and relationship management strategies. He joined FEMA in 2010 and has led Region 2's outreach on flood hazards. Thomas uses principles in selling to win over indifferent or skeptical audiences. He has also served as a communications coach, developing trainings to help emergency managers influence the behaviors of decision makers and the public. Thomas, thank you so much. Your previous webinars have been a huge hit with our audience, and I look forward to today's presentation. I'll hand it over to you.
Thanks, Deb. So I want to ask everyone for their cooperation and an open mind. So if you all could just close your eyes for a second, I want you to vision a face. Doesn't matter if it's you, someone you know, or if it's just a cartoon face. Get that face in your mind. Have that face yawn. Now, it's probably the worst thing to do as a presenter to get their audiences to yawn, but I wanted to kind of exercise how powerful it is that we can use our words to influence people's behavior. This leads us to our first poll question. Did you feel a yawn coming on? Did you actually yawn? And Allison, can we get that first poll question up? Okay, there we go. So everyone's got the poll. Okay. And for those of you who said you didn't feel that yawn, you could just try it again. Again, keep an open mind. Don't fight the urge. But again, the face. It could be a cartoon face. But to have that face yawn. So it seems evenly split. Okay, it looks like a couple people have been doing it again. So it seems pretty evenly split. Well, we're going to get into how we could influence people, trying to sway them to listen to the lessons that we have to teach in our jobs. And today, thank you, Allison, to take that poll out, please. We're going to go into storytelling. And we're going to break this into two sessions. And first, we're going to get into the science behind stories, why we all love them, and why we are influenced, or how we can be influenced by them. And it's not just this feeling that we have, but it's actual science and research behind it. Now, at the end of this half, we're going to have our volunteers do their first round of stories. So we've got three volunteers, and they're going to tell their stories. And like previous sessions, we really want you, the audience, to provide feedback. And one should understand, it is very difficult for people to just get up here or get on a camera and face people that they've never met and to do this. So please, respect them, let's be professional, and let's provide positive feedback. Does it mean that you have to sugarcoat it? But let's put it in a way that they would benefit from. Because as we'll see, and we've seen in previous sessions, both you, the audience, and the speaker really can get something out of this as we practice what's being taught. And then the second half, we're going to go into some storytelling tips. We're going to really get into it. And then at the end of the second half, we'll have our volunteers again tell their stories, changing them based on your feedback. And then we're just going to have a friendly competition to see who has the best story. So let's start off with the science. Good stories, just not about being entertained. We actually learn from it. Now, going back to the old Geico commercials, where it was so simple a caveman could do it, it has actually been shown that as we began to communicate with each other, we told stories. Those cave paintings, you didn't see a spreadsheet. You didn't even see a step-by-step instructions on how to kill the woolly mammoth. It was done by stories. And our brains are actually genetically coded to learn. Because if you think about it back then, if somebody said, hey, you can take a branch and hit a saber-toothed tiger over the head with it, and that would make that tiger run away, well, they don't have the luxury like us to go to Google and research it. They might want to know what the proof is. So if he said, Grog, over there, scared witless because a saber-toothed tiger encountered him, and he grabbed the first thing he could, which was a solid branch, hit that tiger over the head, and we've all felt how that feels on our own head, and that tiger did not like that feeling and ran away. And so the story puts the context behind some of the lessons. And it's almost that social proof that, hey, there could be something to this. And what we've seen and what researchers have shown is that our brains do work by getting in the middle of what is being told. And so what we've seen or what has been proven is that facts alone just doesn't cut it. In fact, what they've seen is that stories, when somebody is put into a middle of a situation where they have multiple senses working at the same time, areas of the brain that are being triggered, other than just being told something, they have a 22% chance of remembering that lesson from a story more than being told by facts. In fact, we've seen that stories are contagious, that a good story gets passed on from one person to another. And that's something that we in the emergency management field, as we are trying to educate our local officials, our public, or whomever your audience is, we want that force multiplier. We tell 10 people, And if those 10 people tell 10 people, and so on, we can get our message across. And so stories are a very powerful way of getting our messaging and our lessons through to our constituents or to the people we serve. And researchers also found that, you know, it's just the way our brain is set up. Now, in very simplistic terms, if you look at the brain in three different regions, you have the reptilian brain, you have the limbic system, and then you have the neocortex. And that reptilian brain is a complex. It's built with the brain spine, where the spine hits the brain, and it is kind of the core area of the brain where it is just instinctual. It controls some of our most basic bodily functions, some of our deepest instincts that we don't think about. And that develops at birth to about 1 year old. And then you have the limbic system that as the baby becomes older and matures, other parts of the brain start to develop. And a little bit more complex, like the emotions and the learning and the primary memory. And then finally, we have the neocortex, which is really kind of the elevated part of our brain where this really separates us from other animals. We can imagine the spatial reasoning. There are so many complex things that we as humans can do that other animals can't that have allowed us to achieve so much. But as much as we have evolved, we still have our basic animal instincts. That reptilian brain. Think about it. What do you do when you hear a sudden noise? Most of the times we'll stop short. We'll lay still. Our senses perk up. Our eyes, our ears, we listen because we think we're in danger. And this is a very survival instinct that we have, that we are genetically coded to keep us alive. We don't move. Because we don't want to make more sound. If we are being hunted, you want to lie still. These are things that, even in our modern life, there are still a lot of relics or a lot of activities that we have done throughout our lifetime that maybe is not as relevant. There is no saber-toothed tiger chasing us down the street. But yet, when we hear that sudden noise, we stop. And as our brains have evolved and the way we socialize have evolved, we have become a lot more complex. And the two of the most common biases that we often encounter, especially when we are talking with an audience, is cognitive dissonance and cognitive bias. And cognitive dissonance, very simply put, that we often have more than one opinion or one viewpoint on an issue. And oftentimes, they are in conflict. And when they are in conflict, it causes a discomfort. That's the dissonance. And we need to get rid of that discomfort. We don't like to feel that pain. So we justify so that we pick one side and we justify why we did. Just like I like eating donuts. I know they're bad for me. I really want to eat this donut. So maybe I can say to myself, having one donut isn't that bad. Or I'll just work out a little extra today. I need to resolve that conflict about having that donut. And people do this all the time. And the discomfort, it is real. People do not like to be told they're wrong. They don't like their position or their opinions to be attacked. And I have a personal example. Just the other day, I went to Home Depot. I'm trying to fix my bathroom faucet. I'm struggling with it. I'm getting down and dirty. I'm hurting my fingers. I have the wrong tools. I'm constantly going back and forth to the store to buy something, only to realize it's the wrong piece. Finally, I take a picture. I think I've gotten it all figured out. I go to Home Depot. I ask for help. Someone at the store says, well, I was wrong. I have the wrong dimension. I'm telling them, no way. I've gone through this. I've spent days figuring this out. I am not wrong. And he finally shows it to me. And then I remember, oh, I have a picture. So I look in my camera, my phone, and I see that he was right and I was wrong. I had the worst feeling in my stomach that I had to admit that I was wrong. This was and this was the wildest thing. It's been a while, and maybe it's been a while since I've actually had that self-realization. But because I was doing this webinar, it really made me think, this is that cognitive dissonance I always talk about in a very different form, but true nonetheless. And so I did apologize to him, and I admitted, hey, you were right and I was wrong. And I have to tell you, it got easier, but I still felt that discomfort, you know, that bile taste, that it just, as the words came out, it did not come out easy. But at the end of the day, that was the right thing to do. And I felt better because of that. And so when we're talking to our audience, many times they won't have that time to self-realize or realize that they were wrong and you were right. And so we need to ensure that as we are getting our messaging across, the lessons that we are trying to teach, we do so in a way that is non-confrontational, but yet does not yield our position. And stories are a great way to do it. And cognitive bias is very simple. When we do have something that challenges what we believe, we often disregard it and we find things that support it. So there have been numerous experiments where people were given opposing viewpoints, write-ups, articles, research. And they found that instead of changing minds, what people are doing are they're just digging in deeper. They're getting more defensive. So understand that when you're going into a situation where you're talking to an audience that may either not understand what you're trying to get across or feel that what you're trying to do is attacking something that they believe in or something that they don't want to give up, often this is how they're feeling. We need to be understanding. We need to figure out ways to break through that. Because as communicators, we are not there to tell people they are wrong and we're right. We're there to help them. We're there to keep people safe. So breaking through the wall. A lot of times we'll throw statistics. We throw science. We try to have a rational argument where on the other end, it's a little bit more emotional. Why people don't want to give ground or admit that they're wrong, often anchored in emotions. And so we continue to have a rational argument for an emotional purpose, and we wonder why we sometimes don't succeed. What stories do is you can tell a tale. You can get your lessons across without actually telling them what to do or what to think. But as people get immersed in your story, they are feeling it for themselves. And they may come to that conclusion that you want them to, on their own, not you telling them. This often keeps them a little bit unguarded, open to those ideas. And it is a powerful way to influence people's thoughts. And the immersion, this is the most important thing. We've all been to the movies. You've seen those horror movies. Nobody ever goes into a theater and says, well, I think Jason from Friday the 13th. Hi, can someone just put themselves off mute, put themselves on mute, please?
I don't know how to do that.
Okay, Roger, can you please hang up and we'll try to give you instructions via email? Thank you. We don't go into the movie theater thinking that Jason from Friday the 13th will just come out and murder us. And yet, when we're watching that movie, that suspense, we get scared with us. And what we see is that when we get immersed in the situation, more parts of our brain are activated. They're engaged. When you lecture somebody, they're listening. And what research has shown is that there's only about two parts of the brain that are really engaging. The synapses are shooting off. But when you're immersed in a story, one that you're really into, the brain lights up. And you're hitting so many components. And that's one of the powerful ways of making stories memorable and really being able to teach or embed an idea in somebody's mind. And further research has shown that when you are immersed in the situation, that there are feelings that we have, and these are all chemically based from the brain. Again, you go to these horror movies, you know nothing bad will happen to you, yet you feel the adrenaline rush. You feel the cortisol, you're scared. Do you fight? Do you fly? Do you hold onto somebody's arms? Do you jump from your chair? These are all things that are not really happening. Our brain being engaged in that story. This help is causing you to have that situation, experience it secondhand. Gives you all those feelings as if you were experiencing it yourself. We all know that some of the best ways of learning something to experience it yourself. And many of the things that we are talking about in emergency management, we don't want people to experience first. So through stories, we can keep them safe, have them learn from either others or the stories that you're telling. This is the best way to get that messaging across, to keep people safe, to have them experience it secondhand, so that these lessons really stick with them. And understand that when you're telling somebody facts, like a lecture, they're just hearing it. But when you tell people a story, they're feeling it. And further research, this person who is pictured, Giacomo Rizzoletti, probably butchered his name, but he was working on with a research team, and they were mapping the brain of a monkey as they were doing motor functions. And they wanted to see what areas of the brain were engaged when the monkeys were doing simple tasks, complicated tasks, etc. Then the story goes, one day, the electrodes are still in the monkeys, attached to the monkey. And one of the researchers sat in the middle of the room and started eating their lunch. Then he heard the zzz, zzz, electrodes go off. They realized that the monkeys who were watching this researcher eat, their brains were going off. And they went and looked into it further, and they found that the monkeys who were watching this person eat had almost the same experience. That they're part of the brain where it was about getting nourishment, the feeling of satiation of eating something when you're hungry. These all went off. And so what they're calling it is mirror neuron, watching somebody and having that same experience yourself as being the foyer. Trying to do that at the beginning with the yawn situation, because we've often thought, hey, yawns are pretty contagious. And it's not just because it's yawning per se, it's watching somebody do something and being influenced by that action. This happens with a lot of new parents, or just parents of young children. I remember when I used to feed my kids when they were small, that every time I put the spoon near their mouth, my mouth would be open. They didn't think about it until one day my brother said, you know, you always have your mouth open when you're trying to feed your baby. And it just comes back to the mirror neurons, this principle, with including the reptilian brain, that we as animals have taught our children, these babies, whose brain is not yet developed, that if we open our mouth, babies will often imitate us, how they learn. And so this is something that we don't lose, that we may take for granted. But as a storyteller, as someone who is trying to teach a lesson, it is one way to really get your messaging across, to immerse people, to get them to think and feel the situation so that they can come to the conclusion or that lesson learned that you're trying to get across. Okay, so right now we're going to start with our volunteers, and this will be our first round. And again, I want everyone to be courteous and respectful. Please listen, jot down some notes, write it in the chat box, let the speaker know. And what I want you guys to talk about is, first, what you liked or what you thought worked about the story, and then areas where you thought areas that can be improved, or what you'd like to have heard. Our first storyteller will be Lynn. Lynn, can you unmute yourself and start your camera, please?
Okay, I'm working on my camera, my webcam. Hi.
Okay, can you hear me? Lynn, I can hear you and we can see you.
Great.
Okay, thanks, Lynn, for agreeing to do this. Again, you have about 2 to 3 minutes. Tell us a story, a lesson, or something you've said in the past to an audience, or something that you try to get across working at the USDA. Are you ready?
Yep, I'm ready.
Excellent. Go.
I just want to preface this with the understanding that the Forest Service, the parent agency, is the USDA.
I'm sorry, Lynn, hold on 1 second. Raja, can you hang up and I will give you a call right now? Okay, Lynn.
Okay, great.
Go.
Okay, thanks. I just want to make sure that people understand that the USDA is the parent agency of the Forest Service. That's not always clear. So that's all. And I'll start. Landslides and the Hoback River and the National Landslide Preparedness Act. As a Forest Service employee, have you ever seen the effects of a landslide? I have. I was canoeing on the Hoback River in Wyoming. Over the winter, a large landslide had come down and partially choked the river. As my partner and I approached the landslide choke channel, unaware of what was ahead, the current became faster. Trees and rocks were strewn all over the channel. We made it about halfway down before we hit a rock in the channel and took on too much water. We capsized and swam to shore, a little shaken up and pretty cold, but unhurt and with all of our gear. With all of our research online prior to this trip, no one told us that landslide was there. Thank goodness it was only a minor mishap. Landslides cost millions of dollars, damage critical infrastructure, and kill people every year. What do you, as a Forest Service employee, want a national landslide hazard reduction strategy to include? What would be the best way that I could have learned about that landslide on the Hoback River? My name is Lynn Carpenter, and I'm the new Geologic Hazards Coordinator for the National Forest System. We have an opportunity to act on this. Every one of you are an important part of implementing the new National Landslide Preparedness Act, what we're calling the NLPA. As part of the NLPA, a USDA representative will sit on an interagency coordinating committee on landslide hazards. Within the first year of the NLPA, the committee must develop a national strategy for landslide hazards, risk reduction, and incident response in the U.S. We collectively have a chance right now to contribute our experience, ideas, and recommendations to our USDA committee representative. What do you want our USDA representative to know? What do you want him or her to prioritize? Road repair, campground hazard identification, landslide inventory, incident response development? Each of you bring a unique experience, knowledge, and understanding to our USDA representative. As the Forest Service's National Geologic Hazard Coordinator, I would like to capture your information, ideas, recommendations, and experience so that I can provide comprehensive support to our USDA committee representative. Let's avoid another Hoback River incident. If you are interested in being on a landslide panel for your region, please reach out to me and let me know. I can be reached at lynn.chastain-carpenter@usda.gov. Thank you very much.
Great, Lynn. Thank you. Thank you so much. Okay, so I want the audience to just use the chat box. Please provide her some feedback. Tell her, what do you think worked? And again, areas you think could do with some sprucing up or some improvement. Now, Lynn, what my initial thing, I thought it was very informative. Okay.
Oh, thank you.
I think you speak very clearly, and you come off very intelligent. Like you just really know your stuff. Now, what I would ask you though, do you know of a situation where it would encapsulate kind of what you were trying to get across, right? Did something ever happen where somebody experienced this and then came back to you and said, hey, you know what, I worked with you guys, or either we avoided it, we're better positioned to avoid it the next time, or something to that effect, or now we've mitigated it. What does anything come to mind?
No, I've only been in this position for a few months, so I haven't had that opportunity to have that experience. I'm trying to think of something that might work for that. You mean instead of the river story?
Yeah, or do you have is there something more to it that that can be gleaned out of it, or do you know? Go ahead.
I could recommend a solution to the story, basically that there's some kind of a website where these kind of hazards could be alerted to the general public where I would have found it.
Okay. Let's see. Well, let me think. What is it about the story that you really like? How about that?
The story?
Yeah.
It kind of highlights that, well, two things. One is that the landslide can occur, and then months later you can still have repercussions from that landslide. And two, it highlights that information needs to be disseminated to the general public as well as to Forest Service employees.
Okay. All right. So, Allison, you've been looking at monitoring the feedback. Anything you want to share with Lynn?
Yeah, I think a lot of really good feedback here. I think you got a lot of interest from just the drama that was happening with your story. I think some people thought you were speaking a little fast, but I think you had some really strong feedback from just your first kind of run.
Yeah, I was looking at a couple of them. Wasn't clear how this was connecting to what decision we, the audience, needed to make. Okay, that's a good point. I have to look at that.
Yeah, and again, Lynn, look, I know you're in a tough position here. You've told the story. Yeah, no, and I appreciate it. Again, I think you're taking it like a true professional. I think people are being very professional with their feedback. You know, here are some speaking tips that I have. And again, not knowing you well enough and not having heard you speak for just more than this 2 or 3 minutes. It seemed a little tight where you kind of want to get things right. Like, I think you sound very intelligent. You sound like somebody who is committed. And when you get up there, you don't want to come off as either unprepared or you know, you kind of want to do it perfectly. Does that sound right, or what do you think?
Yeah, and actually I changed it kind of last minute, so I didn't have a chance to go through this version, so I was a little nervous about that.
No, yeah. And that's fine. Look, you know, one of the things you can always start off with, hey, I'm new in this position, but tell us why this is so important. Like, this is important because everybody's got to learn, not just the public, but even you as mm-hmm. forest rangers or whatever it is. And it's something like, let go. You know, everybody who is watching you, they're not expecting perfection. What they want from you, they want to see your passion. They want to see what you care about. I don't think you lack that. And you come off as very sincere. And these are your strong points, you know, and that, I'm telling you right there, you engage people. That's what people love to see. Where nobody's sitting there like, oh, she got this wrong. Oh, my gosh, she got, no, no. But they're like, does Lynn care? Does Lynn care about me? Does Lynn care about her job? Does that make any sense?
Yeah, it does. I'm kind of scrolling through the comments as well. So, yeah, I think I need to emphasize the time sensitivity of this project because we have, like, 4 months to get all this information from the Forest Service level people. So I think I need to do that because I don't think that it came across. That okay. I need it that stated yesterday, but we only have a year, and then, you know, it's kind of complex with the, you know, administration change and all that too. So
yeah, okay.
Weird stuff. Yeah.
So here's something to think about, right? That last point I think mm-hmm. is great. So mm-hmm. let's put the listener in that situation. Have you ever been in that situation where, you know, you're running out of time, and as you get closer, the game changes, and you're almost starting from, you know, step one. And what we really need to get this done, we need everybody's understanding and cooperation. And that's kind of the, it seems like what one of the things you would like to get done. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So Lynn, you're going to get a...
What's that?
You're going to get a chance to do this again, and you can change up whatever you want. But again, I think you did a great job. I think from based on the comments, I think people really appreciated it. So in the second half, we'll go over some more pointers. And before you do your second run, we'll give you some more tips, and we can ask some questions, workshop it, and we'll hear you do it again. Is that all right?
That sounds good.
Excellent, Lynn. Thank you very much. Lynn, can you please put yourself on mute and turn off your camera? Okay, so our next speaker will be Sally. Sally, can you unmute yourself and turn your camera on? Okay, Sally, I'm not hearing anything. Okay, I see you. Okay, can we do a sound check? Can you say hello? Okay, can you get your volume up a little bit?
This volume?
Perfect.
This volume?
Excellent, you sound great now. Thank you, Sally. Okay, so Sally, you're in the middle of a presentation or in the beginning or what have you, and you want to introduce your story. Go.
So I have a confession to make. When I was in my 20s, I lived on an island in the Pacific. If you can visualize Australia and just continue to go north, and that's Papua New Guinea, and then north of that, about 7 degrees north of the equator, is Palau. I was there. Scuba diving, having a great time, and my friends and I heard a major explosion type of collapse, and another friend of ours came and really tried to motivate us to go to the bridge. The Koror Babeldaob Bridge had collapsed. My confession is that even though today I work for the Office of Disaster Assistance with the Small Business Administration, I didn't start off being somebody who really understood how to follow a protocol and be, number one, prepared for any kind of emergency, because when the bridge collapsed, I chose to go to my friend's refrigerator and freezer and start cooking food. Not just for me, but for my friends. But the bridge was the main artery from the airport, and it also carried fresh water to the island where we lived. So being a bridge collapse was the collapse of an economy, a livelihood for many people. And in my 20s, you could kind of say that I was sort of like the, you know, the wolf in a wolf pack that is not the alpha wolf, and it's literally just the babysitter wolf. That's what that wolf gets to do. So that's what I did in my 20s. But now I'm here to say that I understand why it's important to be prepared for emergencies because they come. And with the Small Business Administration, what we do is when disasters strike, we are alongside FEMA and we help with long-term recovery for disaster survivors. So we help, strangely enough, even though our name is Small Business Administration, we help homeowners, renters, businesses of all sizes, and nonprofits. So that's what I'm here today to talk to you about, the loan program following Tropical Storm Isaias.
Okay. Is that it?
I literally just, when we started, I realized I did not prepare correctly, so.
No.
When you were doing the limbic and the brain diagram, I thought, oh, wow. I didn't mobilize to help anybody with an oxygen tank.
Yeah. No, let me tell you, Sally, that was awesome. And you can't see this now, but you had me smiling from the beginning, and you have me smiling now. What a great way to start off a story. I have a confession. Who does not want to hear a confession? Everybody wants to hear a confession. You know, that is the way to immediately start to draw people in. This was a personal tale, and something that I'm going to get into a little bit later, but while it was about you, it wasn't about you. You weren't puffing up your chest and, hey, I'm the greatest and I'm so smart. I am fallible. And this is a story of learning from a mistake. Not necessarily a mistake, like what I'm saying was what you did wrong, but you now look at it in hindsight. And this is something, who does not do that? We all learn from our past. And so that's a universal theme that gets you. And it was a beautiful tie-in. And I think there are elements that you can tie this in a little stronger. But what an amazing job. Okay, Allison, what kind of feedback were we getting from the audience?
Well, everyone really loved the kind of, God, let me find it up here again. There's so many great comments about like tropical, hold on. tropical story, something like, oh, there it is. Confessions from a Tropical Paradise. I thought that was a great title. But yeah, everyone thought your conversational style was good, but it could tell that there was maybe a little bit of you really thinking through kind of what you were going to say next, which I think we kind of discussed already. And just make sure, you know, to work on the lead-in to the actual message, really.
Codes from PulseNet and phylogenetic relatedness from NCBI. And utilizing these results, we consistently communicate results using reports that we generate. So this slide shows the multitude of biologicals analyzed by FSIS. We have approximately 65 establishments that we regulate, and each year over 100,000 samples are collected. Of these, about 250,000 microbiological samples are analyzed, and around 16,000 regulatory and non-regulatory bacterial isolates are characterized. Each week, we sequence around 300 isolates. So these are some of the customers who receive and utilize WGS results. The applied epidemiology staff, Office of Policy and Enforcement, OPHS leadership.
Okay, so Sally, can you please mute yourself and shut the camera off? Thank you. Okay. Raja, do we get your headset all squared away? Can you unmute yourself?
Yes.
Excellent. Thank you. Great. Now can you start your camera, please? Awesome. I'm glad we got this all. Thank you very much. And thank you, everyone, for your patience with this. Okay. So, Raja, again, you are a community emergency response team volunteer. You said you're working on a project in San Diego, or I'm sorry, in Huntington Beach. You're talking to an audience. You want to tell them a story. Go.
Okay. I'm going to tell about the story that happened 20 or more years ago with my son, who encouraged me to become a CERT volunteer a lot. It was like the Edison High School in Huntington Beach where he was going, there was a drill going on, and my son have autism and he is in the special there, and thinking that participating in a drill with a son with an autism will be a very good, there was a big mistake on my part. When I took him there, there were so many firefighters, so many teachers, special education teachers, everybody was there, but that's a big, big no-no. My son could not handle the public and the crowd. He was really, really screaming and agitated, making a big cry.
Your metadata about isolate and NCBI session numbers to CDC PulseNet via the Binumeric software. Binumerics will request FSIS raw sequence data from NCBI. Using the accession numbers, the raw sequences will be from NCBI to CDC PulseNet and undergo WGMLST analysis. WGMLST results are shared in with FSIS in the form of allele codes of MLST types and entered in FSIS LIM system. The Listerian nomenclature using allele codes are represented in the examples here. Allele codes can be used as a zip code to signify how close isolates are on a tree, and these allele codes are going to vary by organism. In the example in the top left, you can see that if you count out after the dash, each allele code shows how many alleles apart they are. And below, you'll see that the first two in the example are indistinguishable. The fewer amount of allele codes that are shared, the more distant two sequences will be. For the purposes of FSIS, sharing four allele codes is considered a match. You can see this here when comparing
other sequence patients. Can somebody type in the chat box if they're hearing another presentation right now?
No, that's because I stopped the broadcast for a second. I'm going to try to disconnect and reconnect the room to the audio.
Okay, everybody, we are trying to reboot the system. Okay, it's connected. Is everybody hearing me fine? Can you please put that in the chat if you're hearing me? Okay, are you hearing anything else? Okay. Bada, yeah.
It looks good now.
Okay.
Sorry about that.
Yeah, sorry, Raja. Again, can you please continue? Sorry about that. It was a great story. I hate to do this, but please continue.
And after that, Do you hear me okay now?
Perfect.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, I have this says, how do you want to join the meetings, audio board? Should I exit out?
Yes, just exit out.
Okay. Okay, here I am back. Hope everybody hear me okay. That was a big step in my life, big challenge, big fear, and my experience at that time, think of somebody could not handle the social journey, and how he was screaming. He had schizophrenia at that time when we took him to the doctor and find out. And later, I became very, very involved in the community emergency response team. And I went all the way through. Right now, I am volunteering with a social bridging project, Listos California Social Bridging Project. I am talking on the dialer sometime, 9 hours a day, with calling all the people. And regardless of whatever is happening, my journey continues in volunteering and reaching out to people like 96 years of old people, 100 years old. They can talk, but still, you have to know the people and then interact with them. And that's the thing. Like, even with my own son, I didn't know he had problem and challenges. And right now I feel I'm mastered the skill, and I'm doing really a good job with like a 100-year-old. I know whether they can speak or they can hear. They have a hearing ability. Communication is difficult. That's what we call and talk to them and become a good resource for them. And that's a good thing. I participated in a lot of volunteering activities that no one would believe why I am doing this like this. So there is a heavy component in it, which sometimes make me really cry. But to get out of that, I believe, you know, interacting with a lot of volunteering is helpful.
No, that was a great story. And I know some of you couldn't hear the first half, and Raja was talking about a personal experience with her son. He has autism, and one day there was a drill, and there were a lot of firefighters, and there were a lot of people, which caused her son a lot of stress. And her, as a mother, felt the pain. Raja, did I get that right?
Yes. Thanks.
And this compelled you. And so what I love about your story is, you know, you shared a little bit of your personal pain with the audience. And it was very sincere. And who doesn't feel for that? And this is kind of your motivation of why you do volunteer work. And not just you doing the volunteer work, but for us to say, boy, is there something more we can do? How do we take something that could be very painful and do something positive? Because Raja, you don't have to volunteer. You can just be upset or feel sorry for yourself, but you wanted to take action. You wanted to help others. What I think is you don't want people to ever go through what you went through as a mother. Am I right?
Yes.
That is an amazing lesson, right? The love of our children, to protect others who need the most protection, these are things that nobody can argue against. That was a great story. Allison, I know people only heard some of it. Some people only heard half of it. Any other feedback you would like to share with Raja?
I think the main feedback that we're getting is everyone being able to give a sense of empathy based on your story. And they really connected with your story. And they really appreciate your passion as a mother for helping your son. And I think it's a good way to get across kind of your personal tie to volunteering and to CERT.
Yeah. Great. Okay, so, and Raja, next session, we're going to go over some more points. We're going to give you a couple more tips, and then you'll get to tell your story again. Is that okay?
Yes.
Excellent. So can you please mute yourself and then turn off your camera?
I would need some guidance. I don't want to do anything wrong and, lose the good one. So let me...
The camera is off, and if you can, don't worry. Yeah, we've had a few things go wrong already, so let's just pile it on. Okay, and this is what happens in the virtual world. But look, we have heard some informative stories, inspiring stories, emotional, and we can see how that it's just not us listening to the words, but that we can get drawn in, we can get sucked in. And we start to connect with the speaker more, and we are in a situation that they put us in, and we're coming to our own conclusions, or whatever it is. And so that is, again, not just, hey, it's a good story. It's just in our genes. This is how we're coded. And as once we understand that, let's use this. And so the next half, we're going to go over some tips and some do's and don'ts so that we can all refine our storytelling skills. We can all craft a great narrative and help us achieve our organization's mission. At this point right now, we're going to take a 5-minute break, so it's 3 o'clock. Please, everyone, if you can get back on at 3:05, I've got a video to show you as an example of a great story. And again, we're going to go over some storytelling tips, and then we will have our volunteers do their final round of storytelling, and we will give them a little bit more advice on what we think would improve their story. So please, join us. 3:05. Thank you very much.
Okay, I paused the audio broadcast, so no one can hear us now.
All right, can you get me off the camera before... you put this there.
Yeah, I got it. Yeah.
Yeah, okay. All right. A couple hiccups.
Start with that audio. I have no idea what was going on with that.
I thought Steph was going to do something lewd.
I think it was something with the room, because once I disconnected from the room and rejoined, it went away. So I don't think it was the phone line, so I'm not really sure what wires were crossed there about bio-pneumatics or something.
Yeah, I didn't hear anything on the phone line, so.
I had my computer speakers on.
Yeah, I checked my computer speakers and I heard it. Whenever I see somebody say that there's a problem with the sound, I always check my computer.
Okay. Well, it is what it is. This whole week, every webinar I've attended has had hiccups. So this is what happened. All right. Good stories. Lynn, are you on? And Sally and Raja?
Yep.
Okay.
I'm on.
Yep.
Okay. All right. How was your experience? Was it okay for all of you? Anything we can do to improve your experience?
No, I was fine. This is Lynn. I was fine, I think. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, definitely. Okay, good. Good. Anything else, Allison, Deb?
I'll hit you up offline.
Yeah, okay. And I think timing-wise, we're kind of on track.
Okay, good.
Still,
that was one.
We still have an hour.
Yep.
I think we're going to end up ending early. Allison, were there any questions for Thomas? I see the box looks clear here.
Yeah, it was all just comments on the story.
Okay, so we need to remind folks to add questions for Thomas specifically, not for our volunteers, the Q&A pod.
Yeah, I was going to do that once he started speaking again. I didn't want to confuse them while everyone was sharing their stories. So I'll definitely do it a couple times while you're doing your second half presentation.
Okay. Do you want to kick off the second half with that, or do you want to?
I was going to go ahead and put it in the chat box right now. Right now.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So what did we start with? Participants, like 150.
We're hovering around that right now.
Yeah, okay. I think I saw like 160. I think I saw like 160-ish at the peak. So,
okay.
Yeah.
All right. So hopefully we don't lose too many people in the second half. And Phoebe, thanks for stepping in there.
No problem.
That was awesome. Yeah. Look, I don't know why Deb says the things about you. I think you're awesome. and we'll leave
we
it at that.
Lies like a frog.
Oh, you got that right. Okay. Let's see. I'm looking at the future slides. And... All right. We got 1 minute. I'm getting some water.
Allison, you opted not to turn your webcam on then.
I did.
Reminded you.
So, I was reading my script when you said webcam in the chat, so I didn't see that till after. Looking over. I need to do like a camera preview to make sure. My living room's such a mess right now, but I guess people understand. We got a bunch of new furniture, and it's like a mess. I wish
but
I had the blur background.
You're in Jersey by now.
I know, right? Sometime. We'll get out of here eventually, get some more space. It was nice over the break to have that again. Okay, I think it's almost time. Thomas, you ready?
He went to get water.
Okay, wait for him. But, yeah, being back out in the burbs again definitely gets you interested in, like, more space.
Well, is Blaine going to the office every day now in Jersey?
Yep, he is. So,
well, at least he has a reverse commute.
Yeah, and they have a private shuttle right now.
Who's got it better than them?
Okay, I'm back.
Okay.
Allison, do you want to get to, I heard everything, so let's see your messy living room. Get your camera on and let everyone know to put their questions on. And then tell them about Blaine and his company job.
Do I have to?
No, you don't.
Okay.
You don't
have to. I actually did shower today, so I do look happy. All right.
Did shower today. Okay, on that note.
Yeah, exactly.
You can remind them hygiene has really gone downhill in this pandemic.
Yes.
You could remind them when you start speaking about adding any questions about the content of the portion that you're delivering. Okay?
Sure. Yep.
Let's go.
Okay. All right. I'm going. Starting now.
We don't hear you, Thomas.
Okay, so welcome back, everybody. Thanks for coming back. And I just want to remind everyone that there is a box for questions that you have for me. Feel free to type it at any time. We will also have a Q&A at the end of this session, but if something comes to mind, please use that chat box. I get paid for every answer, so much. Okay, yeah, so for all the other people on the line, please mute your phones, and we're going to start the second half. And just a slight continuation. Oh, wait, I'm sorry. Robert, you're saying that you tried to type something and nothing took. Well, Robert, that probably means you asked a tough question, and I only take softballs, so thank you very much. We'll have Allison look into that.
Thomas, can I add a sec? So nothing, you won't see anything in the Q&A pod until we post it. So if you would just go ahead and type it, if the question is appropriate for Thomas, then we'll publish it. So you won't see it until we publish it.
Gotcha. Thanks. So Robert, I don't know if you're from New York or New Jersey, but we have a tough crowd here, so we need to filter and censor to spare my feelings and not get in trouble with the authorities. So anyway, let's go back to the presentation. We're going to continue on with some of that science. What researchers were looking at with presentations, they were tracking people's brain waves. You know, where the brains are, where what parts of the brain were going off when the audience was sitting and listening and when the presenter was speaking. And what they found is that when an audience gets truly engaged, you know, when that speaker connects with the folks that are listening, that their brainwave patterns actually start to sync up. So if you're telling a great story, it's further proof that you can influence, or you have a better chance of influencing people, because those brainwaves, you become very much similar. You're on the same wavelength. This is an important thing and very powerful for a speaker. Because we all know that stories could be so engrossing. Who doesn't like juicy gossip? And it seems that gossip isn't a new phenomenon, but it's been around for ages. Even started when we were living in caves, and as soon as people started to congregate and become clans or tribes, there was gossip. Gossip helped people survive. Gossip, not as we know it, but back then were stories of other people, of other tribes, of how others have done this. Or, if you're looking for a mate, how Grog has the most woolly mammoth pelts, or whatever it is. These stories that were told throughout social organizations really could help and promote people's life and further society. So there was a time when gossip was actually very positive. It's not to say that that's not the case now, but we do gossip. We are a very social animal. And Simon Sinek, who wrote the book Start With Why, and he had a great TED Talk, I heard him speak about how we are clans. That, you know, I grew up in Queens. When I'm in Queens, I grew up in Bayside, Queens. I meet someone else from Queens, whatever. I go into Manhattan, and I meet someone from Queens. Oh, hey, do you know so-and-so? Do you know so-and-so? And when I travel to Europe, and you hear someone with a Queens accent, you're like, hey, are you from Queens? And you find out that you're from maybe the same neighborhood. All of a sudden, this complete stranger becomes so important to you. Or their recommendations or things that they say, you take to heart. But if you met that person down the block from your house, they probably tell them to just get the hell out of your way. Now, in the chat box, has that ever happened to you? Have you ever met someone in a distant area far from where you're from? And you find out that they were actually from somewhere close to you? Isn't that a strange phenomenon? So going back to that reptilian brain, as advanced as we think we are socially, intellectually, we are still some of the most basic forms of us as a cave person. And so we understand that when we do the gossip, it is part of our socialization. So let's take this to heart. Let's learn something from this, and let's use it in a positive sense as we progress our organization's mission. Now, I just kind of added this just for the interest of everyone. For every movie or story, there's basically 7 plot lines. They're all kind of a derivative of one of these. Nothing earth-shattering, but I just wanted to include it as something that could be fun or interesting for people who care. And now I want to show a video. Allison, do we have that video ready? Okay, so I want to show a video, a quick video, and I think it was a very engaging story, and let's discuss what we liked about it once we hear it. Sorry, Allison. I want to hear from you guys. What did you like about that story? What do you think worked? It was heartwarming. It was. There was just something about, and who knew that the web could be that emotional? It was a kind of that insight, something very similar to like Raja's story. It's a personal insight. Somebody shared something so personal, the love of their daughter, being a new father. At the end, just a sign off as a generic dad. These are things that really can connect people. It's the use of the emotional heartstrings that we all have and that we can tug, because most of what we're trying to do, not cut and dry, we're not accountants. We don't try to save people money or make people more money. What we're trying to do is we're trying to save people, because especially in FEMA, what we've seen is the devastation that some of these natural or man-made events can do, that have on people, and that if we can protect them, or if we can reduce the damages or the impact of that next event, that is a success. And yet you would think that that is simple and cut and dry, and everybody would accept you with open arms, but it's not. They don't. And there's some misunderstanding, and there's a need for us to communicate. Not just the importance of our mission, the fact that the mission is about them. And one of the things that we sometimes struggle with is, how do we get more people to take those actions or to dispel that misinformation that keeps them from making themselves safer. And so what I would ask is that think about it. Think about the emotional part. Stop just reciting facts or statistics. Really, start thinking about how do I connect with my audience? And stories are a great way, as we've seen with the folks that are the volunteers in this video, it's a great way to pull people in. And talk about drama. So Freetag's pyramid, it's basically the structure, a basic structure of all stories. Act one, it's the setup, the background, what's happening. Act two, the action, what's going on, what are the obstacles? And this is the rise, and we finally get to Act 3, the resolution. Here is the obstacle has been overcome. And then Act 4 is the aftermath. What happens after that climax, big resolution? And finally, we end in Act 5 to close it all up, to end the story, to close the ties. And to get your theme across, Act 3 is where they recommend you get your moral, your big idea, the themes. Get that out at that peak. This is when everyone's interests are at their highest. This is when the big sigh of relief happens. Everything has been done. Then we see what happens afterward, what the new norm is. So when you think of the story that you want to tell,
there are
for us to be instructional, do we want to teach a lesson learned? Think about what kind of story you want to tell. And then figure out what that you either experienced yourself or that you've heard from others. One of the one of my mentors, she's a person who I think is a tremendous public speaker. She told me something about, and I'm thinking, she said, good speakers borrow, great speakers steal. Don't be afraid to tell somebody else's story. If it fits what you need to get done, use it. If you want to keep it factual, do that as well. But understand, it's not the story per se, but it's that lesson that you're trying to teach. And once you figure out what kind of story you want to tell, why is it that you want to tell this story? What are you trying to get accomplished? And this is very important because it needs to be clear. A story for itself, for entertainment purposes, hey, that's great in a social setting. And there's nothing wrong with that. But in a professional setting, once you have the audience's attention, and it is a gift, right? They are giving you their time and their attention. We need to make the most of it. And so think about structuring that story, and the what are you saying, and now the why. What is it that you want to do? What is that mission? What is the lesson you want to get across? And once you have that, we can start piecing things together. How do you make it a great story? Sometimes detail can make all the difference. And in this book, the brothers of Chip and Dan Heath, they wrote this book, Made to Stick. It is a great read. It is an amazing read on how to be someone who can speak and be memorable. And they have one scenario where they ran an experiment where they had two groups of people. I'm sorry, they had a group of people and they had two different write-ups. And it was basically, it was a legal case, and the scenario was the mother was considered to be unfit for her small child. And in one paper, they wrote her defense, and you know they were basically refuting that that she was a bad mother and that she did everything she was supposed to. And in the second one, they added in tons of detail. And the one detail that stuck out was that she would brush her son's teeth using a Star Wars toothbrush that looked like Darth Vader. And in their conclusion, Dan and Chip, they realized that the audiences gravitated towards the details, that the details made things truer, made things more real. And the fact that you can get into something like a toothbrush that looked like Darth Vader, for the reader, for the listener, to them, that must really have happened. Or it was more substantial. Not that she just brushed his teeth, but she brushed his teeth with something so specific you knew it happened, or that she cared. Dan and Chip also came up with the power of three, or I think it's the rule of three. Don't try to get too many things across. Don't try to teach too many lessons. I've read somewhere it can go up to five, but five is pushing it. Anything more, people start to just kind of tune out, and they don't listen, or they won't retain any of it. Dan and Chip believe that three is the magic number. Three messages, three ideas, three examples. And they list throughout literature, a lot of stories revolve around the number three. And when you use references, make sure it's relevant. Everybody looks at this picture. Most of you, if not all of you, has had a lemon or knows what a lemon tastes like. So let me ask you guys, when you look at this lemon being squeezed, does it give you that tart flavor in your mouth? Does it make you salivate or kind of give you that experience of a lemon taste? Isn't it incredible? There's not even a real lemon in front of you. Cecilia says, I can smell the fresh scent, just visually. And this is, and Gail, I'm sorry that you squirted in your nose, but this is an amazing thing that you can, your mouth will react to an image. And if you describe it, that's almost just as good. So when you're telling that story, get into the details. Look at that lemon and describe it so that if we took this picture out, people would still have that feeling in their, that taste in their mouth and that reaction. And this means that you're triggering different parts of the brain. You're engaging different areas of our sensory perceptions. And this is a powerful way to not only engage people, but again, get them in that situation and influence their thoughts. Because if you use something that they're not relevant, that's not relevant to them, it gets lost. Now, I don't know how many people know what kind of fruit this is. I had to Google, you know, the most exotic fruits. But I look at this and it looks interesting. But I don't have that same reaction like I did the lemon. I don't understand what that tastes like. What would happen? I don't know what to anticipate. And I have no reaction. Now, here's an example of doing something that's regional. I'm in the Northeast. This fruit is this fruit happens to be found in Hawaii and the far Pacific. And so maybe if I was in a coastal area in Hawaii or in Tahiti, I can talk about this. And this would actually play very well, because if the local folks know this, they know that I'm using an example that's very that's relevant to them, and it shows some, it'll help with our connection. But if I did this in the Jersey Shore, people just would have no idea. So use things that are relevant, unless you're specifically trying to make a connection with a local group. If that is even greater and has a great impact. And as we explain it, sometimes we don't have the luxury of having pictures, and telling a story doesn't really require it if you use those descriptive words. Paint pictures with your words. Make people feel something. we use the word synergy. What does that do for you? There is no image that comes to your head or the feeling on your skin. But if you talk about something that is icy cold, we all kind of have an idea. Or that lemon where, you know, you squeeze it and you feel the acidity on your skin. You smell that fresh lemon taste. And as you describe it, you put people in that situation. So when you're telling your story, add a few of those descriptive elements. Really paint that picture. Don't just say words or throw numbers, because sometimes it just gets lost in an audience. And when it comes to numbers, especially in emergency management, we like to look at the big picture. We talk about the big impact. Thousands of people. You can't relate to 1,000 people. I can't relate to a town. I sure as I could really relate to the individual. Just like that Google commercial, Dad. He was one person going through this experience and sharing this with us. And there's a connection there. There is a relevancy. And I felt that I understood more. I got more out of it. And while 1,000 people or 10,000 people being hurt in a flood or a hurricane, it's not great news, and I feel sorry for them, but it's hard to relate. But if you told the story of one person who was impacted by that storm or event, how they were impacted, what they were feeling, I can relate to that. And that would be a lot more powerful than talking about widespread damage. And then it comes down to how you tell the story. We don't want to be monotone. Speak clearly. And if you're not sure of yourself, that's fine. If you're not sure of the story, nobody expects you to have a perfect delivery. But do try to change the tone up a little bit. Emphasize the important parts. And you don't always have to yell or raise your voice. Sometimes lowering your voice gets people to listen. When you're monotone, people start to kind of zone out. When you switch it up, it makes them more attentive. And then when they hear a drastic change in pitch or pace, it gets people to look up and listen. And I've said this in, I think, the last webinar, use the pause. It's the easiest thing to do, and it is so effective. It helps you regulate your pace. Am I speaking too quickly? Am I speaking too much? Take a pause. Am I doing too many ums and ahs? Pause. Look for that word. Buy yourself some time. But it also breaks up that cadence, really makes it interesting. And so if we go back to Shelley's story where she said, I heard a loud noise. Pause. Let it sink into people and move on. And this is a very easy way, and I say that if you can bring it into the way you speak and deliver, you're going to be much better off for it. And you'll realize how easy it is to do. And timing. Look, you got to edit your stories. The last thing anybody wants to hear is somebody go on and on and on. Those stories have to get to the point, set up quickly, get to your conflict, get to the resolution, and as that five-act play plays out, get to it. Do you want to spend more time on one part than another? But really work on it and edit, edit, edit. And finally, the worst thing is when people use this platform to talk about themselves, kind of brag about how great they are or how amazing their experience was. Be humble. That's not to say that the story can't be about yourself. Absolutely. Don't use it as a platform to talk about to play out some of your things that you are so proud of. Remember, these stories are not about yourself, about fulfilling something about yourself. It's about helping them. And then finally, if going back to kind of where our brains work, this is Josh Boyer. He's got this great TED Talk on the feats of memory that anyone can do. And he started off as a reporter. And he looked into professional memory competitions. He wanted to know how these people remembered, you know, 1,000 random numbers or hundreds of playing cards in the right order. And as he got into it, he tried to do it himself. And we may have heard of mnemonic devices, you know, words that trigger certain things. He actually talked about learning a technique where it was a story, because it was easier for the brain to remember the story and have the stories trigger the things that he's trying to remember, as opposed to just random numbers, random names, random words. So if you have time and are interested, it's a great TED Talk. There's a number of others, and they're all kind of the same way. They talk about stories, and they go off on, and the crazier the story is, the better you'll remember it. Okay, so before we get to the questions, we're going to do the final round, and we'll have our volunteers tell their stories again. Lynn, you're the first one up, and you turn on your camera, and you're already off mute. Okay. So, Lynn, what I want you to do is, for this version, what I'd like you to do is take two or three things, items, that were in your story, and I want you to get into a little bit of a, be more detailed and describe it. Okay? And I'd like you to inject pauses, at least two pauses in your presentation.
Two pauses.
Do you think you can handle that?
I can handle that.
Okay. All right. You're in the middle of your presentation or in the beginning, whatever it is, and you want to get into your story. Lynn, go.
Great. Thank you. My professional life has just gotten an injection of adrenaline. I was just promoted to be your National Forest Service National Geologic Hazards Coordinator 3 months ago, and now I have 1 year to help implement the newly passed National Landslides Preparedness Act. Have you ever been affected by a landslide? I could have been killed by one. I was canoeing on the Hoback River, an easy river near Jackson, Wyoming. We did not know it, but over the winter, a large landslide had come down and partially choked the river, creating a new rapid. As my partner and I approached the landslide choked channel, the current became faster. Trees and rocks were strewn all over the channel, making it go from an easy class 2 to a much more challenging class 3. Where did this come from? We were not prepared for this. We paddled like crazy and made it about halfway down the new rapid before we hit a rock, capsized, and swam to shore. We were shaken up and pretty cold, but luckily unhurt and with all of our gear. It was one of those laugh because it's better than cry kind of moments, but it could have been deadly. We were so lucky. With all of our online research prior to this trip, no one told us that that landslide was there. Where should we have looked to find out about the landslide? Thank goodness it was only a minor mishap. Landslides cost millions of dollars, damage critical infrastructure, and kill people every year. What do you, as a Forest Service employee, want a national landslide hazard reduction strategy to include? What is the best way that I could have learned about that landslide on the Hoback River? My name is Lynn Carpenter, and I am the new Geologic Hazards Coordinator for the National Forest System. We have an opportunity to act on this. Every one of you are an important part of implementing the new Landslides Preparedness Act. As part of the National Landslides Preparedness Act, a USDA representative will sit on an interagency coordinating committee. Within the first year of the NLPA, the committee must develop a national strategy for landslide hazards, risk reduction, and incident response. Did you hear that? We have 1 year to put a comprehensive strategy together. It's due in January 2022. We collectively have the chance right now to contribute our experiences, ideas, and recommendations to our USDA committee representative.
What do you want our USDA representative to prioritize when developing this national strategy? Landslide inventory, incident response planning, public information portals, which would have helped me on the Hoback River. Each of you have critical experience, knowledge, and understanding about landslides on our national forests and grasslands. I would like to gather your information, ideas, recommendations, and experiences so that I can provide comprehensive support to our representatives. Let's avoid another Hoback River incident. If you're interested in being on a landslide panel for your region, please reach out to me at my email below. I can be reached at lynn.chastain-carpenter@usda.gov. Thank you very much.
Lynn, that was awesome. How did that feel to you? Did you like this version better?
I think it's clearer what I'm asking for.
Okay. Now,
the time sensitivity of the data that I'm wanting from the staff in the field.
Yeah. No, and I thought that was very clear, but your personal experience, that was, it was great. And here are the three things that I wrote down. When you go talk about the class two, the class three rapids, you know, think that if people don't understand what that means, try to explain to them. Like, what is a class two rapid? What's that like? If you were to explain it, just make it up.
Class two is a novice boater could boat a class two.
Okay. So class just anybody would.
You need to be intermediate or above to be competent on a class three river, and the consequences are much greater.
Okay. So in a class two, if I stuck my hand in the water, how much drag would I feel? What kind of pressure would my hand feel?
It's not necessarily the speed of the water. It's more the obstacles in the river. So
okay. Okay.
Class two would maybe have one rock in the middle of the river, whereas a class three would have two or three in the same area, so you have to dodge around them and stuff. But yeah.
Okay. Perfect. So how about this? Class two is as if you were walking in your basement and you saw one nail on the floor. You could easily just avoid it, right? Class three, it's now you got about 10 nails on the floor. Can you do it? Yeah. But are you paying attention? Heck yeah.
Yeah.
Right? Or whatever the analogy is. So I would say, you know, stay away from the jargon, but if you could make it a little bit more perilous, it all of a sudden's like, holy wow, that's incredible. And yeah. When you talked about the landslide, which was great, describe, what did that landslide look like? If you were to explain what that actually looked like, what did it look like to you?
Looks like a bunch of drunken trees on a hillside because they're all like...
That's awesome. Okay. That is great. In this landslide, how many, do you think a house would have been destroyed or completely enveloped in this landslide? How many houses?
Yeah, it was big.
So what would you think? Four houses, a suburban block? What do you think?
Well, it blocked the road for 3 months, and that's why we were so surprised that we hadn't heard about it. So, yeah, it took them 3 months to get all the material off the road.
Okay. So think about that.
At least a decent residential house would have been completely, at least moved off its foundation and probably smashed in the process. Yeah.
And that right there, describing that landslide to, again, if your audience is the layperson like myself I'm a city guy, I don't know what a rapid is, I know what fast-moving sewers look like, you know, these are different perspectives. Right. But if you can explain a landslide where if there was a house there, that house would have been either moved 20 feet or just all you would see is the front step, and that was it, like the, you know, the witch at the Wizard of Oz.
Right.
And that is like, it's scary. That, you just, you know, you paint a scary picture, and it was harrowing. And your swim, what was going through your mind when you did that swim?
I was trying to catch the canoe. I didn't want to lose the canoe because that was our only way out.
So
there's several miles.
Desperation, fear, was that going through your body?
The first thought is always, isn't that cold?
Okay, and describe that. What is that cold like?
You know when you jump into something really cold and you like automatically inhale like deep shock inhalation, right? Yeah, cold. And then mostly it's about not getting beat up by the rocks yourself as you're floating down the river trying to catch your canoe.
Yeah, there you go. So those explanations right there, those are beautiful. So what I would suggest is add those elements into it because you really bring the listener in. Allison, what kind of feedback do we have for Liz?
Everyone really loved the presentation. I thought they saw a lot of improvement. Maybe just talk a little bit slower and a little more pauses. I know we kind of had a timer up today. But slow down a little bit. Everyone thought the visual details were good and the kind of scope that you gave. And I think Thomas also just mentioned, you know, some other details you can even provide more information on that'll really put, people have that picture in their head. And I think people enjoyed the drunken trees, so that was kind of a funny way to describe it.
Well, it's funny because it's exactly what it looks like, a bunch of trees that got drunk and can't stand up straight anymore. So, yeah.
That's awesome. Okay. All right, Liz, thank you very much for your participation. Okay, if you could just mute yourself and turn your camera off, please. Thank you. Sally, you are up next. Sally, please unmute yourself and turn your camera on.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yes, Sally, thank you. Okay, so for this round, again, try to find those areas where get a little bit more dramatic, you know, the bang. We just heard this loud noise. And what I'd like you to do is take two or three elements,